بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. My name is Joe Gabriel. I came all the way from Canada simply because I love Manchester and I love the Muslims in Manchester. So just want to let you know, originally Egyptian but I live in Canada and I'm a professor at Al-Azhar University, but currently I moved back to Canada when I was teaching at the University of Alberta. I was teaching Islam there, and I'm one of the Maghrib instructors. And tonight, inshallah, we're going to be talking about the best of the stories in the Quran. We're going to derive some lessons from Surah Yusuf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Furqan, Surah number 25, and number 30, there is a complaint in that ayah. And the complaint is by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O my Lord, my people, my followers have deserted the Qur'an, have abandoned the Qur'an. And in his commentary on this ayah, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, هَجْرُ الْقُرْآنِ خَمْسَةْ مَرَاحِلِ أَدْنَاهَا هَجْرُ الْقِرَاءِ. He said the desertion or the abandonment of the Qur'an is 5 degrees. The least of which is to desert the recitation of the Qur'an. Of course, reciting the Qur'an is greatly rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all know the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud when he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Manchester sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, من قرأ حرفا في كتاب الله كان له به حسنة. Whoever recites one letter, he didn't say one word or one ayah, no, one letter, he will be rewarded. وَالْحَسَنَةُ بِعَشْرِ أَمْثَالِهَا. Meaning that reward will be multiplied 10 times. And then he said, لَا أَقُولُ أَلِفْ لَمْ مِمْ حَرْفِ. And I wouldn't say أَلِفْ لَمْ مِمْ is one letter. وَلَكِنْ أَلِفُ الْحَرْفِ. But أَلِفْ is حَرْف. That's 10 حَسَنَات. لام حرف, that's 10 حسنات. ميم حرف, that's 10 حسنات. Can you repeat after me? ألف لام را. ما شاء الله, you made 30 pounds with Allah. Sorry, 30 حسنات with Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We always think in terms of money, right? That's the only currency on the Day of Judgment. And we only see it when we believe in the Quran. So, the least of the desertion of the Qur'an is to desert or to abandon the recitation of the Qur'an. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided us to recite the Qur'an. What's next? How many times have you heard about a hafiz and the family makes a party for them? But then what's next? There could be a hafiz who does not know one single word of what he's reciting. Right? So the next step is, listen to these ayat in the Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Don't they reflect and ponder on the ayat of the Qur'an? Or they just read words and they cannot go through the meanings because their hearts are sealed because of their sins. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, every time a person commits a sin, a black drop falls on his heart. And when he continues sinning, what happens? The person's heart is covered with a black layer that forms a barrier between you and connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at that point, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the ayah in Surah Al-Mutaffifin. كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. وَالرَّانُ هُوَ السَّوَادِ. It means, because of their sins, a layer of blackness covered their hearts. So when they stand in salah, which means connection with Allah, they do not connect. Because there is a barrier between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet ﷺ said, أَلَا إِنَّ الْقُلُوبَ لَتَصْدَعُ. Indeed, the hearts get rusty. قِيلَ وَمَا جِلَاءُهَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. They asked, how can we remove that rust? He said, تِلَاوَةُ الْقُرْآنِ وَذِكْرُ الْمَوْتِ. Two things that will remove that rust, that barrier between your heart and connecting with Allah. Recitation of the Quran and remembering death. These are the two things that will remove that rust, that barrier between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, it was only 3 years after we became Muslims that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us this message. Listen carefully.
أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ.
Isn't it time for the believers that their hearts would humble due to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the truth that has been sent in the Quran to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Isn't it time? So they were crying and they said, it is time, oh Allah, it is time. So my question to Manchester tonight, is it time? Say yes or yes. This is why I'm here. Tonight and over the weekend, inshallah, to revive that message of the Quran. To reconnect with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you imagine, back in the days, anybody here like 70 years and up, like me? Anybody like 60 and up? Okay. Okay. You know, back in the days, we didn't have email, right? And when your fiancé or your wife, if you are traveling, send you a message. There was no texting. There was no WhatsApp, right? So the only way was like a written letter, right? By mail. It takes a year on the back of a camel, right? And then once you get the letter, what do you do with it? You open the letter, right? And you start reading the letter. And it takes you an hour to finish it. And once you finish it, you fold it the same way and you put it under the pillow. And you have nice dreams after that. And every time you feel longing for that person, what do? You open the letter again. Right? And you read every single word, imagining. Right? And these are the words of somebody who's beloved your heart. Am I right or right? What about the words of Allah? Are they beloved your heart? When you hear them, do they bring tears to your eyes? Imagine the Prophet ﷺ would be walking in the streets of Medina, he would hear a woman reciting, and he would cry right away in response to her recitation. What was she saying? Would you like to know? Hello?
Yes.
Are you here? Would you like to know what was she saying?
Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to talk with you, okay, not at you. She was saying, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ الْغَاشِيَةِ. Did you hear about what's going to happen on the day, the encompassing day, that's the day of judgment? And the Prophet right away, he pictured that day, he started crying because of the horrors that will happen on that day. He started crying and said, نعم أتاني, نعم أتاني. Yes, I know that day. And we read in the Quran many times, what's going to happen on that day? It's 50,000 years long. Right? Umar radiallahu anh is walking, and he hears somebody reciting an ayah. Once he hears the ayah, he falls off and he gets sick for a month. Everybody was visiting him without knowing why was he sick. The reason he was sick because he just reflected on the meaning of the ayah. Do you want to know the ayah? Now or inshallah in the class? Now. The ayah was,
إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ لَوَاقِعُ مَا لَهُ مِن دَافِعٍ.
Indeed, the punishment of your Lord is going to happen. Nobody can resist it. Nobody can stop it. SubhanAllah. They had living hearts. This is why they used to interact with the Quran. What's happening to our hearts today? We need to reconnect with the word of Allah. This is why we have tafsir classes like this. Along this weekend, we're going to stay with Surah Yusuf. Surah Yusuf was my PhD. I spent with Surah Yusuf 5 years. I'm going to summarize it in 2 days. But there's a teaser on Friday for free. For anybody who's interested, you know, to come for free on Friday, inshallah, between 7 to 10, and the brothers will give you the venue, inshallah. But tonight, I was told to speak for 4 hours, for 40 minutes. Okay, the number 4 now, you know, anyway. So inshallah, we're leaving by midnight. Are you ready, inshallah? And then we'll give you 10 to 15 minutes, you know, inshallah, Q&A. So the first thing that I want to share with you, because Surah Yusuf is an encyclopedia. When I sat down to choose it as my PhD topic, subhanAllah, I jotted down 300 themes in half an hour. And I can do this with you now if you want, but we don't have time. Okay, just talk about anything. Finances is there, famine is there, corruption is there, you know, bad governance is there, how to deal with crisis is there, parenting is there, jealousy amongst brothers, it's there. Just name a subject, it's there. SubhanAllah, the miraculous language of the Quran is there. So I'm just going to go through a few lessons, inshallah, some linguistic stops, and then some lessons in life, inshallah. And the first lesson is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the beginning of the surah says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام را. What does that mean? Nobody knows except Allah. These are called الحروف المقطعة, right? Separate alphabetical letters at the beginning of some surahs. And if you combine them all, there are 29. But how many letters are repeated? There are only 14 letters that are used at the beginning as huruf muqatta'ah. How many letters are there in the Arabic alphabet? Anybody knows? Where's my candy? Do you have candy for me here? Okay, we'll promise you on Friday, inshallah. So, how many letters in the Arabic alphabet? 28. So, Allah used 14 in those huruf muqatta'ah. As if He's sending a message to the Arabs who were masters of the Arabic language. Only 14 letters are used at the beginnings of some surah to challenge you. And the whole Quran is composed of that alphabet that you master. Can you make up a Quran like this? And Allah challenged them 3 times. He said, make up a Quran like this. They couldn't. Allah took it down to 10 surahs. He said, can you make up 10 surahs? No, they couldn't. Allah took it down to the minimum. Read in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2 and number 23. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَإِن كُنتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِّمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا.
And if you were in doubt about what we have sent down to our slave servant, that's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning the Qur'an.
فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ.
Make up one surah. فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ. The like of the Qur'an.
وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ.
And bring all your supporters besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them. He said,
فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا.
If you were not able to do this, لَمْ negates the past.
وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا.
لَن negates the future. And you will never be able to even make up a surah like the Qur'an.
فَاتَّقُوا النَّارِ.
Set a barrier between you and hellfire by submitting to this Qur'an. But do you know that some of them tried to make up a Qur'an like this? But it was very funny. Would you like to hear a funny story? Okay, 2 people only are interested, so I'm not going to give you any stories. When I say, do you like, I want to hear like, you know, at least 200 yes, okay? It's gone. Next time, inshallah. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Ra at the beginning of the surah, as if He's challenging the Arabs. Only Allah knows the secret behind these letters, okay? But the only interpretation in most of the books of tafsir, as if Allah is challenging the Arabs, because the Arabs, they used to write poems. They were like very famous poets amongst them. And a poet would be very respected and highly, like held in high esteem in the community, and he would be the leader of the tribe. And they used to compete, right? In every age, there is competition, right? So at the times of the Arab, they used to compete in what? They used to have like fairs for poetry. So they will have the poets, they will come and compete. Everybody would write maybe a 400 lines of verse without making the slightest mistake in rhythm, rhyme, grammar, syntax. And the winning poem would be written in gold and will be hanged in the Kaaba, being the most sacred place on earth. And this is known in the Arabic literature as Al-Mu'allaqat. What do we compete in today? Miss Universe? I don't know. Anyway, that tells you, mashallah, how people, you know, where they're focusing. So subhanAllah, Allah is challenging the Arabs, oh you masters of the Arabic language, can you make up a Quran like this? This is the first message. تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ الْمُبِينِ. Anybody speaks Arabic here? Raise your hand. Don't be shy. Okay, what's the meaning of al-mubin? Clear. MashaAllah, that's good. Is there something more than clear? Because clear means bayin. But when Allah says al-mubin, it has extra meaning. MashaAllah, that's a good meaning too. So, yes? MashaAllah. The brother said wadih or bayin, meaning clear. But what I'm asking for, it has extra meaning than that too. Meaning, when I say bayin, it means clear in itself. But when you say mubin, it means clear in itself, and it also provides clarification. Bayin wa mubayin laghayri. Like when you say tahir and tahur, tahir means pure. Tahur means tahirun fi nafsi, mutahhirun lighayri. So when Allah said al-mubin, He didn't say tilka ayatul kitab al-bayin. Al-mubin means it's clear in itself. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ. Allah made it easy for people to learn the Quran. Are there people who are willing to learn? That's what Allah is saying. But in this ayah, Allah said al-mubin, it means it's clear in itself, but it clarifies for people. What does it clarify? It clarifies the two ways. The truth from the falsehood, al-furqan. What's right from what's wrong? What's halal from what's haram? This is what Allah said, al-mubin. Did you see this in the translation? You will never see it. You understand what I'm saying? So the Arabic language is very rich in a way that when you read a translation of the meaning of the Quran, it will never give you everything. I'll give you another example. Allah says, تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ الْمُبِينَ. Allah said, Al-Kitab. What's Al-Kitab? It means the book. It stems from the verb كَتَبَ. كَتَبَ means to write. So Al-Kitab means the documented form of the Quran. The one that's written down in letters. But when Allah says, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا. What's Quran? It's the Quran, right? Exactly. This is the recited form, the oral form. So the Quran was transmitted to us in two forms, right? The written form, the word is Al-Kitab. The other one, the recited form or the oral form, it's called Al. So Al-Kitab from Kataba, to write. Al-Quran from Qara'a, to recite. Okay? How can we prove the authenticity of the Quran that it was transmitted to us through the written form and the oral form? Question for you. Was the Quran written down in one volume at the time of the Prophet ﷺ? Hello? The answer is no. Unanimously, right? No. Right? Was it written down but not in one volume? The answer is yes. Why? Every time any ayat would be revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ was unlettered, doesn't know how to read and write. But he would memorize them. SubhanAllah, you read in Surah Al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا تُحَرِّكْ بِهِ لِسَانَكَ لِتَعْجَلَ بِهِ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا جَمْعَهُ وَقُرْآنَهُ. What does that mean? When Jibreel alayhi salam used to come to the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ was so scared that he might forget an ayah or a word or something, so he would repeat after Jibreel alayhi salam right away. He would repeat again and again. So Allah said, no, don't worry Muhammad. will combine the whole Quran in your heart and you will never forget it. Just listen to Jibreel. Just be calm. So the Prophet ﷺ used to memorize whatever was revealed to him. But if there was anyone around the Prophet ﷺ who was literate, who knows how to read and write, he would write it on whatever was handy at that time. A piece of cloth, a stone, you know those leaves of the palm trees, whatever was handy. And then, a group of ayat are, held at somebody's house, a group of ayat are held at somebody else's house. There was no need during the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ to combine the Quran in one volume. Why? Because it was memorized by hundreds of the Sahaba. But yet, at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Umar came to him. He said, Abu Bakr, he said, yes, he said, I think we should combine the Quran and the Quran. He said, no. What did the Prophet ﷺ do? This is bid'ah. If it was something that should have been done, the Prophet ﷺ could have done it. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to introduce something new in the deen. So Umar had no argument against this. Until the Battle of Yamama came and 70 amongst the Huffaz, the memorizers of the Quran, were killed in the battle. So Umar came again. He said, what do you think now? What if we waited until all the Huffaz are killed? What would happen to the Quran? I think it's time now to do it. Then Umar said, Abu Bakr said, yes, there is a necessity now. So he made a committee of the Huffaz, chaired by the best linguist of that time, Zayd ibn Thabit, radiallahu anhu. He was the main scribe. And they sat down and they wrote everything that was written down and they verified every ayah that was written against two of the Huffaz who listened to it directly from the Prophet ﷺ until they authenticated the full Quran except for one ayah. They found out that only one man heard that ayah from the Prophet ﷺ. Do you want to know the ayah?
Yes.
Do you want to know the Sahabi?
Yes.
Only four people. This is going to be, inshallah, mentioned in the class on Saturday, inshallah, I promise you. Now, let's move on. So this is how we know the Quran was, collected in one volume as Al-Kitab, right? As the written form. But the oral form, alhamdulillah, never stopped. From the time of the Prophet ﷺ, that's what we call tawatur. Never stopped. Until today. And one time, I was giving a speech at the University of Calgary in Alberta, in Canada. And usually we have a theme for the Islamic Awareness Week. And I picked the theme. It was very controversial. And I took the heat for that. I said, our theme this year is going to be, Jesus is a Muslim. And we have t-shirts walking around by on our backs. Jesus is a Muslim. And can you imagine what this would do in a university which is like predominantly Christians? And he was like, what do you mean by this? I said, come to the talk. Someone's going to be talking about this. And then it was an open area. And I was the one who gave the talk. And after the talk, a young man, like a fanatic Christian, he came to me and was like, what do you want to tell us here? Are you telling us that the Quran is the only authentic book? I said, did I say that? He said, no, but you mean? I said, you said it. And I agree with you. I said, you made the statement. I didn't make it. You understood this from my talk. But you know what? I can prove it to you. He said, look, how can you prove it? I said, hold on for a second. Because he studied Arabic for a long time. And he was bringing a copy with him to try to challenge that there are some mistakes in the Quran. And then I said, now, if we take all the books on earth and throw them in the ocean, I can make a claim now. He said, what? I said, there is only one book that will come back. He said, which book? Don't tell me the Quran. I said, you said it. Allah is sending you today, mashallah. And I agree with you, the only book that will come back is the Quran. He said, how? I said, just one second. And the pastor at the university was sitting next to me. I said, pastor, can you recite John 25? I was challenging him in his own book. I was like, huh? I need to get my book. I said, you don't know your book? Shame on you. Man, you're supposed to be preaching people and teaching them the book that you don't know? That's really embarrassing. Anyway, I don't want to embarrass you anyway. But if we throw all the books, do you think that the pastor can bring you the Bible again? And he was like, huh? I said, here he is, ask him. He doesn't know John 25. He has to go to the book. But you know what? Hold on for a second. I know the Hafaz amongst the audience. It's like, hey, you, come here. And we lined up. I said, you know Arabic? He said, yes. I said, hold the book. There is a translation. And a Muslim can touch the one that has English and Arabic. Okay? Because I was like, how come did you give him the Muslim? And then I said, open the book, any page. And start saying any ayah. And we're lining up here in front of you, we're going to continue. So he opened the Mus'haf, he said, okay, 23. All of us started. قَدْ يَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتُهُمْ خَاشِعُونَ I said, oh, stop. Okay? And he said, 55. الرحمن علم القرآن stop. Okay? 59. And then it went on like this, it was like, wow. I said, yeah. So if the book is gone in the ocean, we'll just bring some of these people. In your own city here, there are 45 of them. And across the world, there are millions of them. So we'll sit down and write it again. He said, I'm going home. So basically, we should know the difference between Al-Kitab and Al-Quran. Is it clear now? So Al-Kitab is the written form of the Quran. When was it compiled? At the time of the Prophet or Umar? No. I fooled you. At the time of the Prophet or Umar? Abu Bakr. Yeah. Be careful. Right? And then at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, this was the time when they started printing copies of the only one book. We don't have versions, right? Why? Because there was expansion of the Muslims and they needed to have copies of the Quran, not versions of the Quran. And this is why, subhanAllah, whenever you read, they say, بالرسم العثماني, at the time of Uthman, that was the Quran. So they say it's written according to the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. That's the Quran in your hands now. Now, if we move on, let's talk about a different topic here. So we talked about history, we talked about language. Let's talk about something social in Fort Yusuf. Look at this dialogue. إِذْ قَالَ يُوسُفُ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَتِ إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا وَالشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ رَأَيْتُهُمْ لِي سَاجِدِينَ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تَقْصُصْ رُؤْيَاكَ عَلَى إِخْوَتِكَ فَيَكِيدُوا لَكَ كَيْدًا إن الشيطان للإنسان عدو مبين. Look at this beautiful dialogue between who? Two prophets. A child who would be a prophet, that's Yusuf عليه السلام. The father, Yaqub عليه السلام, a prophet. Who's the father of Yaqub عليه السلام? Isaac, Ishaq, a prophet عليه السلام. Who's the grandfather of Yaqub alayhi salam? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. A series of prophets. The best of lineage. When the Prophet was asked, Man akramun nas? Who's the best of lineage? He said, Yusuf al-Kareem ibn al-Kareem ibn al-Kareem ibn al-Kareem. He said, Yusuf, okay, the best of lineage. And he's the son of Yaqub. The son of Ishaq. The son of Ibrahim. Can anybody compete with him? A question here. Do you have problems in your life? Raise your hand. Or hands. Right? You have problems, right? Could be financial, could be social, could be whatever, right? Could be health problems, could be family problem, could be marital problem, right? And sometimes when it gets so tense, what do you say to yourself? You know what we say? Why me? Oh Allah, I'm a Muslim. I pray 8 times a day. Is it 8 times these days? How many times? 5? Are you sure? In Manchester? Okay. So people will say, like, oh, why? Why me? I'm a Muslim. I even did Hajj. And I fast Ramadan. Do you fast Ramadan? Till Dhuhr. Right? Okay. So basically that's exactly what some people do, right? You think by being a Muslim, then nothing should harm you in this dunya. You should be protected from every evil, right? Life should be perfect in this dunya. And this is why sometimes you compare yourself, like, you know, subhanAllah, I have only 2 children and one of them is disabled. But my neighbors, mashallah, have 5 kids, 6 cars, 2 houses. And the 5 kids, they have blue eyes and blue hair. SubhanAllah, stop here. Are you complaining from Allah? Can we complain from Allah?
لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون.
Allah is not to be questioned. And by the way, Allah will never do anything wrong or anything evil. He will always choose the best for you. But you usually understand this later on. Remember that day when you got sick? That was the turning point in your life and you came back to Allah. Remember that day when you lost your business and then you turned back to Allah? That was the turning point in your life. SubhanAllah! So it looks bad. But there is mercy disguised in that bad. And we can only reflect on that later on. You know somebody by the name of Cat Stevens? What's his name now? Yusuf Islam. Right? SubhanAllah. What brought him to Islam? The best blessing on earth. When he got sick. Because everybody turned away from him when he had TB. Everybody turned away from him. He's like, my fame, my money. Everyone wants me to sign their autograph. Now everybody is turning away from me. He started reflecting, what's the meaning of this life? If I have made money, fame, everything. So what's the purpose of my life? Then he realized the purpose of his life. He submitted to Allah and he became a Muslim. So there could be something that might look bad at the moment, but then later on discover that that was the turning point in your life. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked to the people of Badr, the best amongst the Sahaba. If you read in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, Ayah 216, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing people of Badr, saying,
كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالِ.
Fighting is prescribed upon you now. Why? Because their intention was to stop the caravan, claim back their money and go home. They don't want to fight. They were not even ready to fight. But Allah said, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالِ. You will fight. And then Allah said,
وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ.
You might dislike something, but it's good for you. So amongst the Sahaba, like, no, I don't want to fight. Allah said, you might dislike something, but it's good for you.
وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ.
And you might like something, and it's evil for you. Remember that job? I want to get that job. But SubhanAllah, you made, you know, so much money, but you were involved in haram, and now your life is messed up. So you like something, but it's not good for you. So submit to the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said, and this is very important, the ending of this, Allah said,
وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ.
Never forget the ending of this ayah. Allah knows, but you don't know. Allah knows what's good for you. So be happy with the choice of Allah. That's very important. And this is part of our deen. It's called Al-Iman Bil-Qadr. We accept the act of Allah in our life. Because when you accept, what happens? It's a win-win situation. You are pleased with the Qadr of Allah and Allah is pleased with you. But if you are not, you are unhappy and Allah is displeased with you. It's a lose-lose situation. A wise person would choose a win-win situation. Now let's go back to the dawah. Can you imagine Yusuf, 6-year-old child, talking with his dad? He's saying, Ya Abati. How do the children call their parents now? How do they call them? Is there respect? Hey you, sometimes. Right? You know, sometimes it is like, hey man. SubhanAllah, look at Yusuf alayhi salam, he's saying, Ya Abati. They say, اسلوب, the diminutive form of التصريف في اللغة العربية يدل على القرب والمحبة في القلب. When you use the diminutive form, it means that person you're calling is very close to your heart. So instead of saying, Ya Abi, he said, Ya Abati. In Arabic, it means, Oh my dear father. Do you see that word dear in English? No. It's like, Oh father. That's what you see in the translation. So those connotations in the Arabic language, you'll never see them in the translation. Why? Because it reflects respect and closeness to the heart. That's why he's addressing his father in the most respectable way and showing that he's close to his heart. How can we build this trust today between us and our children? Have you ever heard your son coming to you or your daughter coming like, you know, Dad, I want to share something with you, but I don't have time for you. I'm busy. What do they do? One time, two times. Do you think they will come ever back to you after that? They will only trust their friends. And when they do something wrong, you're going to ask them, like, why are you doing this? Like, my friend does this at school. What's wrong with it? Because you didn't teach them. They didn't have time for them. And I'm going to send this message. Brothers, when we go home, what's our job? Give me one word. When we go home, what's our job? We are? Exactly. But give me the title. You are a father and a husband. And sisters, you are a wife and a mother. But you know what we do? We go home, we're still on the crackberry. Completing our addiction. You know how people go in the malls now, it's like, no. They don't even look in front of them, right? And then they hit the post or something. No, sorry, sorry. Right? We go home and we continue our job. Send emails and your wife is frustrated, like, hey, I'm here waiting for you. It's like, yeah, I'm coming next 3 hours. And then when they start complaining, I'm the first one who does this. I'm not an exception. But I'm saying we need to change this. One time, you know, it has been like almost 3 months. I've never, you know, gone out with my kids. So they wanted to go out. So the eldest one, she's like, no, can we go out? I said, don't you see I'm busy, I'm preparing for a lecture. So she'll just cry and go to her room. And the boy comes like, no, hey Dad, like, no, we haven't, you know, enjoyed your company for a long time. Can we just go for us? Like, no, I'm really sorry, you know. I just have to finish preparing for this lecture. But you know the youngest one? She'll tell everybody, get dressed up. Get ready. And then she comes and is like, Assalamu alaikum. Dad. I'm not talking to Dr. Rada Badir. I'm not talking to the Shaykh. I'm talking to you as my father. We're going out. Are you coming with us or shall we take a taxi? How would you react to this? That makes you feel bad. Right? We all do it. And when you ask somebody, like, no, how many hours do you spend with your kids at home? It's like, you know, 6 hours. What do you mean? On your laptop and watching TV? No, I'm saying with them. And when I say with them, it means quality time. You're listening to their issues, to their problems. He wants to talk to you. And as I said, like last night in Al-Furqan, I said, you know, like the young ones, the very young ones, when they come, it's like, you know, Dad! Dad! And then you leave what you're doing, it's like, yes. And they do like this. Have you seen this before? And then they repeat it again. Dad! Dad! Yes! The same dumb face, right? Meaning, it's like emotionless, right? What are they calling for? Attention. He just wants you to spend some time. Like, look at him. Allah said in this surah, the reason the brothers of Yusuf will kill him or get rid of him, they said, يَخْلُ لَكُمْ وَجْهُ أَبِيكُمْ. We want the attention of our father. And they are grown-ups, not children. They said, يَخْلُ لَكُمْ. The reason we're going to kill him, we're going to get rid of him, they said, اقْتُلُوا يُوسِفَ أَوْ اطْرَحُوهُ أَرْضًا يخلو لكم وجه أبيكم. What's the meaning of يخلو لكم وجه أبيكم? He will just look at you. What does that mean? It symbolizes what? Attention. They noticed that he is giving more attention to Yusuf. But he was right, because Yusuf wasn't a latim. Latim, somebody who loses his mother before puberty. And Yusuf's mother died when he was 3 years old. And those people were grown-ups, but Yusuf was a child. To whom would you give much more care? To a child or to a young man? But subhanAllah, look at the way they judged him. He said, إِنَّ أَبَانَ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Anyway, so going back, the surah is teaching us a lot. The idea that Yusuf alayhi salam, as a child, 6-7 years old, going to his father, addressing him in the best way, showing respect, Ya Abati. And then he shares a dream with him, something very personal. When was the last time that your daughter at that age or son came and shared something personal with you? That tells you a lot. And then another lesson, at the very end of the ayat that I recited, what did Ya'qub alayhi salam advise his son Yusuf? He said, Ya Bunayya, la taqsus ru'yaka ala ikhwatik. Do not share this dream with your brothers. Why? There's a disease called jealousy. Brothers and sisters, listen to this statement. The only people on earth who would wish you to be better than them are your parents, no one else. The only people on earth who would wish for you to be better than them are your parents. Your brothers and sisters will be jealous of you if you do better than them, if you achieve better than them, you know, in school or at the university. Am I right or right? But your parents would love you to be a doctor, an engineer, even though if they are carpenters or plumbers, whatever job that they do. And you do not respect people based on their social status or their job that they do. So he's saying to him, do not share this dream with your brothers. Why? فَيَكِيدُ لَكَ كَيْدًا. They might plot something evil against you. But look at the etiquette and that's a lesson that we should learn. He said, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لِلْإِنسَانِ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. Who would whisper to them to plot something evil against you? Give me the word. Shusuf, right? الشيطان. So Shaytan will be the one who would whisper to them to plot something evil. So subhanAllah, Ya'qub did not blame his sons. Even though they would be the ones who would do it. But he blamed it on Shaytan. Would you like a story?
Yes.
Okay, so we can share a story now. People are desperate now. I wanted to explain the meaning of taqwa. And I think I shared this in my class before here in Manchester. And subhanAllah, we have different interpretations of the word taqwa. It comes a lot in the Quran. يتقون المتقين اتق الله اتق الله. Right? What's the meaning of taqwa? And the best example is this story. You know, how many of you have children between the age of 3 to 10? Raise your hand. 3 to 10. Okay. You know when you leave your house and they're alone at home and you come back, what happens to the house? Total mess. Right? Nothing in its place. Right? And then you bring them, like, who did this? Not me. Not me. Not me. You know, however the number of monkeys, sorry, angels you have at home, everybody will deny. Not me, not me, not me. And then the same thing used to happen to me when they were young. And I was like, come on, like, who did this then? And then my son was like, could it be Shaitan? Didn't you teach us in Surah Yusuf that Ya'qub alayhi salam blamed it on Shaitan? Dad, blame it on Shaitan. And everybody's fair. Enough now, you know. I said, it is Shaitan. But I'm going to catch him very soon. And then I made a plan. We went out, and after we came back, same thing happened. Everything is a mess in the house. I brought them, not me, not me, not me. I said, listen, I know who the shaitan is. I said, what do you mean? I said, I'm going to tell you in a few minutes. So they turned to one of us like, no, did you tell me? No, we're fine. Okay, how did you know? Then I said, I had cameras everywhere. And they're like, huh? I said, I had cameras everywhere. We're going to watch the movie now. We're going to see the shaitan or the shayateen. At that moment, they started confessing. The eldest son said, like, you know, I'm the one who does the bedroom. Speciality, mashallah. The youngest son is like, I'm specialized in the kitchen. And my son is like, you know, your office. Subhanallah. Allah tells us this in the Quran. If you read Surah 50, Surah Qaf, Ayat 16 and below, Allah tells us that we are on camera 24/7.
وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ.
Allah said, we have created man and we know what goes on in their mind.
وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ.
And we are closer to him or her than the jugular vein. This is the jugular vein.
إِذْ يَتَلَقَّى الْمُتَلَقِّيَانِ.
There are two angels assigned here.
عَنِ الْيَمِينِ,
on the right.
وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ قَعِيدِ.
And on the left, they are with you all the time.
مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ.
Whatever an utterance that comes out of your mouth, it's written down. Either here, if it's good, or here, if it's bad. And Allah completed that picture in Surah Al-Isra, when He said,
وَكُلَّ إِنسَانٍ أَلْزَمْنَاهُ طَائِرَهُ فِيهِ عُنُقِهِ ونخرج له يوم القيامة كتابا كتابا يلقاه منشورا اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا.
There is a record of everything that you have said or done that will be given to you on the Day of Judgment. And Allah will say, read your record. And then Allah in Surah Al-Kahf said, what's the reaction of people when they get that book or that record? Allah said,
وَوُضِعَ الْكِتَابَ فَتَرَى الْمُجْرِمِينَ مُشْفِقِينَ مِمَّا فِيهِ وَيَقُولُونَ يَا وَيْلَتَنَا مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرًا وَلَا كَبِيرًا إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا وَوَجَدُوا مَا عَمِلُوا حَاضِرًا وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا.
وَوُضِعَ الْكِتَابِ. The book will be given to you. فَتَرَى الْمُجْرِمِينَ مُشْفِقِينَ مِمَّا فِيهِ. You will see the criminals. Allah called them the criminals. Those who used to transgress the limits and the boundaries of Allah. They will have their books in their hands. They're going to be scared to death because they will find out that Allah missed nothing, but it was recorded. Even if it's a minor sin, sagira, or a major sin, kabira, and they will find everything, and Allah is the all thing. Nothing is going to be missing. Be careful. So to conclude, inshallah, we're talking about a dream. Surah Yusuf is a dream at the beginning that comes to at the end. And in between there are two other dreams. They call Surah Yusuf the Surah of the Three Dreams and the Surah of the Three Shirts. Would you like to know the story of the three shirts and the three dreams? I don't have time for that because my time is coming to an end. But I'm going to share this inshallah in the class if you are interested. Or if you are interested, anyway, you have two options. And we call this Egyptian democracy anyway. So, the point here is, we're talking about dreams. Do we see dreams? Yes. How many types of dreams? Three. I don't have time to give you the details, unfortunately. I'm going to share this, inshallah, on Friday. Friday is still free. You can still come, inshallah. Okay? So remind me, I'm going to talk about the three types of dreams and how should we react to those dreams. How should we do with them? There are three types of patience too, because this surah is beautiful patience, right? Three types of patience. Would you like to know them? We don't have time for them too. But we're going to be talking about them, inshallah, in the tafsir of the surah. But I will conclude with something. Something really powerful. You know, in this surah, we need to identify with Yusuf alayhi salam. If you do this, inshallah, if you have time, and I'm sure Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you 24 hours a day, right? And He gave you 7 weeks. And all the time and all your life belong to Allah. He can take it, claim it back anytime, right? So would you be miserly to give Allah 2 days of your time for someone who traveled all the way from Canada? -50. You guys are like, oh, it's very cold, it's -5. It's -50 over there. Okay? If you forget your gloves, your hands will freeze in 2 minutes. What did I say? Minus what? 50. How do you write 50? 5-0. To the right or to the left? To the right. Okay? So subhanAllah. Some people would say, I don't have time. I'm working. And you know when you work weekends, you get extra money. Yeah. But you know when you go to the grave, you take no money. You take no children. Wallahi, if you dedicate 2 days of your life to this course, the only comments that I get in my email after this class is like, my life changed. This is the turning point in my life. Because all of us have problems. But just compare your problems. Did you lose your mother when you were a child? Say no or no. Did you get deprived from your father while you know that he's alive for 40 years? No. Were you taken by your own brothers, thrown into a well mercilessly? No. Were you sold as a slave and you are the best of lineage? No. Were you taken to serve in the house of the minister in Egypt for years? And you think now it's time to rest. Then, did you get seduced by a woman and accused by, you know, by adultery? No. Were you taken and thrown into jail and you were innocent for 7 to 9 years? No. When you go to jail and you know that you're innocent, how do people feel? 2 main diseases in the West today. Depression and stress. Yusuf was giving da'wah in jail. Can you do that? And after all of this, I dare you all to tell me that you went through something, one out of a million of what Yusuf alayhi salam, and he's the best of lineage. Because sometimes like, I'm a good Muslim. Yes? Listen, the Prophet said, أَشَدُّ النَّاسِ بَلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. Remember this hadith. The people who will receive the hardest tests, the most difficult hardships in life, are the Prophets. ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلَ فَالْأَمْثَلَ يُبْتَلَ الْمَرْءُ عَلَى قَدْرِ دِينِهِ. And then the harder, subhanAllah, the deeper the faith, or the stronger the iman, the harder the test comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you go from one test into another test into another test, you should know that Allah loves you. But how do we take it today? Why Allah? Why are you doing this to me? It's because He loves you. You know why? Every time you get tested and you are patient, Allah expiates your sins. Allah forgives your sins. Allah wants you to meet with Him with no sin. But you need to be patient and accept the qadr of Allah. Is that clear? So this surah is going to change your perception of life. And I will conclude with ayah 101. What's the number of the ayah? 101. Surah number 12. What's the number 12? Surah Yusuf. There's a beautiful dua that Yusuf is making in this ayah. Can you imagine after going through all these trials and tribulations, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Yusuf after this long patience, Aziz Masr. What is he saying at that point of triumph? At that point like where he is, you know, in power. Listen to the ayah and derive some lessons.
رَبِّ قَدْ آتَيْتَنِي مِنَ الْمُلْكِ.
Oh my Lord, you have given me power and authority. But he didn't say al-mulk, he said min al-mulk. Some authority, some power.
وَعَلَّمْتَنِي مِن تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ.
And he taught me some of the interpretation of dreams. He was an expert. You just go with him with a dream and interpret it for you.
فاطر السماوات والأرض.
You are the creator of the heavens and the earth in a unique way.
أنت ولي في الدنيا والآخرة.
I have no one to support me in this dunya or akhirah except you. This is introduction. What do you call this? He's praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's attributing the grace and the bounty to Allah. When you finish a degree, what do you do? Man, I stop that I please. Because it was shaitan, the first one who said, I am better than him. Say, all grace is due to Allah. He guided me to finish a degree. Don't say, I did, I made. You can do nothing without Allah. So Yusuf is saying, رَبِّ قَدْ آتَيْتَنِي مِنْ. This is the first lesson. He's attributing the grace of everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What would he think of Allah when he was in the well, 6-7 years old? Would he ever dream to be Al-Aziz in Egypt? So he's attributing the bounty and the grace to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowledge. Who gives you knowledge? I'm smart. Really? Who gives you the brain? Yeah. Allah taught you. And then he's admitting that Allah is the creator of the heavens and the earth and what's in between. And I'm one of that creation. Who can support me in dunya and akhirah? None but Allah. Subhanallah. This is exactly what we do in al-Fatiha. Before we ask Allah for something, because He's going to ask now. This is a dua. He's going to ask for something. What are you doing in al-Fatiha? Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Malik, Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. What do you want? Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. After praising Allah, you start asking. And that's exactly what Yusuf is doing here. He said,
Tawaffani Musliman.
What's the ultimate goal of Yusuf alayhi salam? I want to die as a Muslim. You don't want to be the king of Egypt? You don't want to be like in power all your life? No, what's his ultimate goal? I don't care about power, I don't care about knowledge. I'm meeting with you, I want to die in a state of submission to you.
وَأَلْحِقْنِي بِالصَّالِحِينَ.
And allow me to join the righteous ones. Ya Allah, Yusuf, the best of lineage, does not consider himself amongst the Salihin. He wants to join the Salihin. What about you and me when we pray Fajr 5 times in a week? What do you consider yourself? Taqi al-Din? You understand what I'm trying to say? So learn from this ayah. That's the last post, by the way, I just put on my Facebook. But you got the answers now. You can just go because the homework is derive 5 lessons from this ayah. Can you imagine if we derive 5 lessons from one ayah? What about 110 ayahs? This class, as I told you, I spent 5 years with Surat Yusuf. I'm going to sum it up for the people in Manchester in 2 days. You'll be missing a lot. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لكم جزاك الله. Mm-hmm.